What if I told you that technology from one of the world's most profitable tech companies was once given away for free?
I had this computer that I was giving away all the designs for freely.
That's exactly what Steve Wozniak did when he built the first Apple computer by hand in 1976. He had a vision of an open source tech world where advancements were made rapidly due to transparency and information sharing. But what happened to that dream, and how did Apple become the closed system that we know it as today? This is the story of how Steve Wozniak's open source dream was lost. In the 1960s, the idea of a personal computer was almost that of science fiction. For many, computers were large, powerful machines reserved for scientific research, large-scale manufacturing, and military operations. Having one in your house would just be bothersome and pointless. Technological advances in the decade, however, brought personal computing closer to home than ever. Moz Technology Inc. began mass-producing microprocessors using metal oxide semiconductor technology. Basically, computer processors were smaller and more powerful than ever, expanding the possibilities when it came to personal computing. Steve Wozniak, or just Woz as he's known, took full advantage in 1976 when he built the first Apple computer, the Apple I, which featured a Moz Technologies 6502 microprocessor. Apple didn't even exist at the time, and Woz had no plans to sell the computer for profit.
I was going to build that computer no matter what it was worth. Turned out to be worth a ton.
He was a member of the Homebrew Computer Club, a group of computer hobbyists in California that often met up to share ideas and learn from each other. He brought his schematics of the Apple I to the group so they could build off of and expand his design as they saw fit.
The first night of the Homebrew Computer Club, when I went home, I said, oh my gosh, the whole formula pops in my head. And I really wanted the world to see that you don't have to imagine that every computer costs $10,000 or something.
Woz has always respected the freedom to innovate and really to push the limits. At the time, he was known for his blue box invention that he'd built with his good friend, none other than Steve Jobs. The blue box essentially allowed its user to bypass the telephone system and make free calls to anywhere in the world. They mostly made the blue boxes for friends and family members, charging just a bit more than the cost of components, and there are some really interesting stories out there on some high-level prank calls that Wozniak and Jobs used to make with the boxes. But back to the Apple I. The Apple I was different. It was like nothing else at the time. While other personal computer kits required the user to assemble different components, Woz's kit was plug and play. It was a full motherboard that included a Moz Technology 6502 microprocessor, 4 kilobytes of dynamic RAM, which was expandable up to 48 kilobytes, and at the time, just the idea of expandability was almost unheard of. A major component was the video output circuitry, allowing it to be connected to a basic monitor or TV. This was groundbreaking at the time, and it greatly lowered the barrier of entry to personal computing. It also had an interface for a keyboard and for cassette tape storage to easily load and save programs. There wasn't a single component or technology that alone made the Apple I incredibly groundbreaking. All of these technologies had been explored in the past, but Woz put them together in a way that nobody had done, and it really marked the start of personal computing as we know it. Woz wasn't interested in making a big profit, though. He was proud of his work and of how it could help others advance computing even further. So he shared the schematics freely with his friends at the Homebrew Computing Club, allowing others to work with his design.
I'd given it away, public domain, because I wanted to start the revolution.
But his good friend Steve Jobs, who had already had a taste of success with the Blue Box project, saw another opportunity. He suggested that they sell the motherboard and use the revenue to fund future projects. And although Woz wasn't overly interested in making profit, the idea of being able to tinker and explore even more was intriguing. Plus, Woz was working for HP, Hewlett-Packard at the time, and he had actually presented and pitched the Apple I to Hewlett-Packard on 5 separate occasions, and they turned him down on every single one. Apparently, they just didn't see a future in personal computing.
Now, Hewlett-Packard, I offered it to them first, the personal computer, but they turned me down 5 times.
Yeah.
5 times for the personal computer.
So on April 1st, 1976, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs founded Apple Computer Inc. and began to revolutionize and really create the personal computing industry. they sold about 150 of the 200 Apple Ones that Wozniak built for the very specific price of $666.66. So they made about $100K in 1976, not accounting for expenses. That is equivalent to about $550,000 in today's dollar. With that money, Woz got right back to work. And on June 10th, 1977, Apple released the Apple II, another leap forward for personal computing. For the time, Apple II had all you could ever dream of in a personal computer. It came fully assembled and ready to operate. And unlike any of its competitors, it featured color graphics. Its expandability options were unheard of, allowing users to add more memory and eventually disk drives. And we'll get back to that. In 1979, though, an application called VisiCalc was released for the Apple II. It was essentially the first spreadsheet application for personal computers. You can imagine how impactful this was for business, education, and science. The app went absolutely viral. In 1980, Byte magazine wrote, "VisiCalc is the first program available on a microcomputer that has been responsible for sales of entire systems." The Apple II was legendary, and due to its versatility, it ended up being produced all the way up until 1993, long after Wozniak had moved on from Apple. Let's talk more about that expandability and versatility, though, because this is where Steve Wozniak's dream started to collide with Steve Jobs' business goals. You see, the Apple II was released with an incredible 8 expansion slots, one of the reasons that made it so successful and versatile. But as the Steve Jobs movie did so well of portraying, Jobs only wanted 2 slots so the machine would be more simple and less intimidating.
Why would you only want 2 slots?
A printer and a modem.
He wanted to cater to the average Joe on the street, and Wozniak wanted to cater to power users. Wozniak also wanted to continue to share the schematics of his designs to help drive the industry, while Jobs begged him not to, as it would help the competition. This difference in philosophy set the tone for the future of Apple. Jobs wanted a closed ecosystem, a tightly controlled experience. He admired companies like Sony for their product design, particularly the Walkman, which had a closed, user-friendly design. As Apple expanded, the tension between Jobs and Wozniak and their differing visions became even more clear. In 1980, Apple released the Apple III, which was largely driven by Jobs' team, and it was a complete failure. Then, in 1981, things took a drastic turn. Wozniak was involved in a plane crash and suffered memory loss to the point where he couldn't even remember Apple for some time. While Wozniak recovered, Jobs took over more control at Apple. The Macintosh, which Jobs spearheaded, became Apple's next big project. But it was far from perfect at launch. Many of the issues were things that Wozniak, with his engineering mindset, wouldn't have let happen. Woz returned to Apple a few months after the accident, but eventually stepped away in 1985 as he no longer felt fulfilled at Apple. Apple struggled in the late 1980s and early 1990s, but saw a resurgence when Jobs returned in 1997. His return solidified Apple's closed architecture approach, which we see today with products like the iPhone and the App Store, where developers must adhere to strict guidelines. The App Store, launched in 2008, embodies everything Woz fought against. It's highly controlled, with limited freedom for developers. It's quite ironic that a tech giant known for its closed ecosystem was initially built by a man whose entire belief system revolves around open technology and information sharing. Woz didn't just disappear after leaving Apple, though. He continues to be a vocal advocate for the right to repair movement, which pushes back against the tech industry's closed ecosystems.
So technology has a purpose, and the purpose is to do good and to share. And it's very important that we're open when we have those ideas, that we have methodologies and ways to present them and bring them to the public.
He's also dedicated much of his time to education by teaching coding and computer literacy and has continued his passion for spreading knowledge and innovating. Despite Apple's trajectory, Woz's dream of an open, transparent technological landscape wasn't fully lost. In fact, it was ahead of its time. The modern open source movement, which really took off in the 1990s with projects like Linux, embodies the very principles Wozniak advocated for back in the 1970s. Woz's belief in sharing schematics and fostering innovation aligns perfectly with the modern open source movement. With his early work, he arguably laid the foundation for this movement, and in many ways, he should be considered the grandfather of open source computing. While Apple went on to become a tech giant with a closed ecosystem approach, Wozniak's contributions laid the groundwork for so much more, both in terms of personal computing and the open source movement. You be the judge, though. Let me know which part of computer history you think Woz will be most remembered for. Maybe he even has another trick up his sleeve for us. And if you want to learn more about Apple's modern success and the 30-year-old software behind it, check out my video on the legendary XNU kernel. Here's to a future of information sharing and transparency, hopefully. Thanks for watching. I'm Anson Alexander, and I'll see you in the next one.